Everyone loves a good movie monster. Audiences seemingly never get tired of them, and the best of them become timeless and see an endless cycle of remakes and rebirths. Great monsters have the ability to capture our imaginations and can invoke a wide array of emotions. Not just fear and repulsion, but also empathy and sympathy. Unfortunately though, the designs of some of the more recent of these monsters do leave a lot to be desired. Now these monsters all look great, and the films they inhabit are often very well made. With today's technology, filmmakers are able to create some extremely fear-inducing creatures. But by putting them side to side, you start to see the issue. The monsters seen today so often go down the same design route. In terms of color, it's often washed out grays and fleshy whites. Now compare that with some of the greats like Dracula, with his black and red, or the creature from the Black Lagoon's green. In terms of physicality, films and shows often design their creatures with long arms and a mouth that opens to reveal a cavernous hole filled with endless rows of teeth. Scary? Definitely. But what do these attributes tell us about the creature? That its only purpose is to kill? If that's the aim, then great, it succeeded. But if a monster is to be truly great, all of its different aspects, from color, texture, physiology, and sound, must inform the viewer about the monster. What is its purpose, and what does it represent? Monsters are a human creation. We've been inventing them as long as we've been self-aware. They are used like any archetypal story device to help us understand the world around us. The best are able to reflect some aspect of the human condition, and if they achieve this, become immortal. To help illustrate this point, I'm going to be using maybe the granddaddy of all movie monsters as an example, Godzilla. From his first appearance in 1954, to 2020's Godzilla vs. Kong, Godzilla has evolved countless times. Today he's presented as a protector of the Earth, but he didn't start out that way. Though on the surface a creature feature, 1954's Godzilla represents a post-war Japan still reeling from the atomic bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Godzilla, or in the original Japanese release, Gojira, encapsulates these post-war fears and anxieties. And this is seen in his design. The shape of his head symbolizes a mushroom cloud of an atomic bomb. His hide, the scarring left on the bodies of those who survived the blast. There is, of course, the aptly named atomic breath, which is a bit more on the nose. Every aspect of Godzilla's design serves a purpose, and helps inform the audience of what the monster is all about. Nothing is superfluous. And in the words of the French writer Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, perfection is achieved not when there is nothing more to add, but when there is nothing left to take away. Not all modern monsters today, though, are lacking in originality. The Ritual's Jotun, for instance, is both creepy and fascinating. And the mutant bear from Annihilation is just utterly terrifying. But today there's no one who knows how to create a monster quite like Guillermo del Toro. According to him, there are a handful of aspects that must coincide in order to create a living, breathing monster. First, it's the silhouette. By just the outline of the creature, The viewer must be able to learn something about it. Then, it's the detail. This also must help to tell the monster's story. It's important not to pile on detail too. Features should only be added if they serve the creature and the world it inhabits. Then, of course, there is color. But perhaps even more important is movement. Does the creature skulk in the shadows, like the xenomorph? Or does it shuffle like the undead? These are all important aspects, and when they work in unison, can create something great. The reason for the lack of originality in the monster movie genre isn't complicated, and it's got nothing to do with the designers behind them. The fact is that today, less and less original visions get greenlit. Companies just aren't willing to support riskier designs, and are more likely to choose the ones that have been shown to make money. So instead of a fresh take on the genre, we get a remake or another entry into an already well-established series. There's still unique monster films out there though. So if you do see something that's going against the grain, do us all a favor and support it.